Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. Thank you so much for tuning in today, for subscribing, for commenting, for liking. Thank you so much. If it's your first time, welcome to my channel. My name is Daphne, and make sure that you subscribe if you're not subscribed. So welcome to Wisdom Wednesdays. We're back again. Let's go straight into the Word of God. Let's read together. Let's read from the book of 2 Samuel chapter 11 verse 1 to 9, which say, "It happened in the spring of the year, at that time when kings go out to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him, and all Israel, and they destroyed the people of Amnon and besieged Rabbah. But David remained at Jerusalem. Then it happened one evening that David arose from his bed and walked on the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman bathing, and the woman was very beautiful to behold. So David sent and inquired about the woman. And someone said, 'Is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?' Then David sent messengers and took her, and she came to him. And he lay with her, for she was cleansed from her impurity, and she returned to her house. And the woman conceived, so she sent and told David and said, 'I am with child.' Then David sent Joab, saying, 'Send me Uriah the Hittite.' And Joab sent Uriah to David. When Uriah had come to him, David asked how Joab was doing, and how the people were doing, and how the war had prospered. And David said to Uriah, 'Go down to your house and wash your feet.' So Uriah departed from the king's house, and a gift of food from the king followed him. But Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all the servants of his lord, and he did not go down to his house." Amen. There's always a time whereby temptations will come. There's a time and a season where the enemy strategically positions certain things to happen. The enemy is very cunning. He knows that you and I are flesh. And when we step outside the place of obedience, the place of functioning in the promise of God, the place of doing the will of God, the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God, we become prey to the conceptions that breed destruction in our life. We become prey to the plans of Satan. We become prey to the things that Satan wants to do to destroy our lives. The Bible tells us that the enemy is walking around like a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. It's very important to be alert. Even as we are praying about spouses, we are praying about so many things. You know, God is releasing marriage. God is releasing spouses to people. So it's a very, very crucial time that you check how you are standing. Check where you are standing. Is it a place of obedience, or have you stepped outside the place of obedience? Here we see King David was in a place of comfort. If you read the previous chapters, we see how the Bible tells us that God gave David rest from all his enemies. If you look at the life of David, we see his life was full of struggles. David was a target of enemies. Because of what he carried, because of his destiny and where he was going, David was a target of the enemy. He always had enemies all around him. David was always in a position, in a place of being envied, a place of people being jealous of him, a place of people fighting him. You know, sometimes you wonder, why do you have so many haters? Why do you have so many enemies? Maybe enemies in your finances, enemies concerning your family, enemies concerning your marriage, enemies concerning your career. You wonder why there's so many struggles and so many things happening. But then little by little, God begins to bring healing. Little by little, God begins to bring comfort. Little by little, God begins to bring rest and peace. And all of a sudden, you realize that those struggles that I had 5 years ago, those struggles are gone. Those enemies that were fighting me 2 years ago, they have disappeared. They have drowned in the Red Sea. All those things that were happening in my life, God has given me rest. God has given me comfort. Now I've met the spouse. Now I have the career that I want. Now I know where to meet the spouse. Now I have the education that I've always wanted. Now I have the job that I always needed. The job that brings fulfillment. Now I have the family that I've always prayed for. Are you in a place of comfort today? Are you in a place of comfort mentally, even emotionally, spiritually, physically? Are you in a place of comfort? You have rest all around you like King David. But the enemy is watching. The enemy is looking how he can destroy, how he can take away, how he can kill, steal, and destroy that which you have today. We see in the Garden of Eden, the place that is called paradise. The Garden of Eden was a paradise. It was a place of beauty, a place where there's colors, where the sun always shines, a place that vibrates with beauty. This was the Garden of Eden. Adam had all things that any man could desire. And he had a beautiful wife, a wife that completed him, that adapted to him,
a wife that suited him, but the enemy was watching. Watching for an opportunity to seize and to strike that which they had built, that which they had inherited, to strike the promises, to strike and destroy their destiny. I don't know about you today. Maybe you say, I don't have all this rest, but you know that the rest is coming. God has revealed the rest to you. God has revealed the comfort that is about to come into your life. God has showed you and confirmed certain things that is about to do in your life. Don't think because it's not there physically or you cannot touch it, it's not tangible yet. Don't think that it is not coming. But as you wait, as it comes in your life, remember to be alert in this season because the enemy is watching. The enemy, maybe he knows the word that has been released over your life. Maybe he sees how your prayers are full of thanksgiving and true worship is emanating and arising from your heart. No longer are you begging in your prayers. Your prayers have changed because you have a sense of knowing about what God is about to do in your life. Your prayers have changed from begging, from fasting, and they've gone to thanksgiving. There's a shift in your life, and God is seeing that shift. The enemy sees that shift. God is blessing you in the season, but yet the enemy is watching. How comfortable have you become, child of God? How much rest has entered into your mind, child of God? How much rest has encompassed your emotional life, child of God? No longer do those friends stress you, those people that used to stress you. They are gone out of your life. They have moved out of your life. Now, those people that used to stress you, they have left. They've moved away. That old relationship that used to stress you out, that you couldn't sleep, those people are gone, and God is bringing you people. He's replacing old relationships. He's replacing old friendships. God is preparing new things for you. Child of God, are you so comfortable that you have left your place of relevance? Are you becoming so comfortable that even now you don't even really pray? Yes, you're making prayers of thanksgiving. Yes, you're doing this and that. But now you're so relaxed because you know what God is doing. You know what God is about to do. You know what God has done. You're so relaxed in your life, relaxed in how you worship, relaxed in how you seek God, relaxed in how you spend time with God. Are your ears becoming so relaxed that you've drawn away from the voice of God, the voice of God that gives instruction, the word of God that gives you instruction? Have you drawn away from the word of God because you're so relaxed, so happy? Everything seems to be going so well. You know, what could possibly go wrong? What could possibly go wrong in this season? Everything is just aligning. The lines are falling in pleasant places. Everything is going so good. You're planning so many different things. Are you so relaxed that you've become unaware of the schemes of the enemy? You know, the Bible tells us, I believe it's Apostle Paul, he says, we are not unaware of the schemes of Satan. We are not unaware. We are always aware of his schemes, even in the place where we are comforted, even in the place where we are content. We are always aware of the schemes of the enemy. Are you aware of the schemes of the enemy? Are you aware of the demons that are being assigned over your life in the spiritual realm? Are you aware of the conversations that the enemy is having in the pits of hell concerning your life? You see, they do not stop discussing about you. The enemy does not stop trying to fight you, don't think, because God is doing so many things that the enemy is not going to fight you. We see David becoming so comfortable, and he decided to stay in Jerusalem. A time when kings are meant to go and fight. A time when David always used to fight. He thought, I have rest from all my enemies, and it's likely we're going to win this war anyway. I mean, we always win these days. These days, I'm a winner. I'm always winning because he that is in me is greater than he that is in the world. And I can see God as Jehovah Nissi. He is truly my banner. He has been my banner for the past 10 years. I can see how God has made me a winner in everything that I'm doing. Just because you are a winner does not mean that you need to be rebellious. Just because you are a winner does not mean you need to stop doing the things you used to do for God. Just because you are a winner does not mean that you need to stop obeying the precepts and the promises and the commands of God. Who are you to stop obeying the things that God has instructed you to obey because you have so much comfort? Maybe your finances are suddenly increasing in your life and you think, you know, I'm becoming rich, I'm becoming wealthy, you know, I'm becoming the it. Maybe you're now wearing designer clothes, your fashion has changed. Things are changing in your life. Maybe your church is now full of people. People are coming to church. There's evangelism. Everything seems to be doing so well in your life. And now you think that you're greater than the commands of God, greater than the precepts of God, greater than the instructions of God. No matter how little the instruction is, obey it. Obey the instruction of God, because the enemy is looking and he's watching. Where can he or she disobey this command? Where can she disobey this command? Then I can have an opportunity just to step in. I can have an opportunity to bite, because the door has been opened through that small disobedience. The enemy is watching. Do you think that the enemy is happy that things are going well for you? Do you think that the enemy is happy that there is true worship coming from your heart? Do you think that the enemy is happy that you're no longer begging, but now you're just thanking God in your prayers? Do you think that demons are very excited about that? No, they are very, very angry about that. They hate that you are in a place of not being stressed out anymore. They hate that you are in a happy marriage. They hate that you are happy in your career. They hate that you are happy in church. They hate that you're always smiling. Why is he or she always smiling? Why is she always happy? You see, they don't like that you're always showing your teeth. And God is saying, be alert, child of God, be alert. In the spring of the year, spring is a time when things are shooting up. Things are growing, things are blossoming. Is it spring in your life? And you have decided to hold out on the things that you used to do before. What is it that you used to do before? Maybe you were serving in the house of God, but now you're getting booked. Maybe you're getting booked and busy. Maybe things are looking out in your career and now you stopped serving in the house of the Lord. Why have you stopped serving God? Why have you stopped serving his people? Why have you stopped doing that which God has instructed you to do? Why have you stopped? Because of the blessing. Why have you stopped? Because of the comforts. Why have you stopped doing that which you used to do before? It happened one evening that David arose from his bed and walked on the roof of the king's house. David was never meant to be walking on the roof at that time. He was never meant to be, because he was meant to be serving God. He was meant to be at war with other kings. He was meant to be fighting battles, because God made him a commander over Israel. God anointed David as commander, but now he had stepped outside of the anointing. You see, it's very dangerous when we step outside of the calling and the anointing. People like Jonah died in the sea until God, in his mercy, prepared a whale for him. God rescued him from the pits of hell. And now Jonah is repenting for 3 days. 3 days repenting. Don't get to a place where you die and you drown and you die. Don't get to the place of death. Don't allow the sting of lust to kill you, child of God. Don't get to the place where you die and you drown in the place of rebellion. Don't allow it to get to that position. Don't allow the enemy to steal what you're building, to kill what you're building, and to destroy what you're building. Do not allow. Do not give the enemy an opportunity in your life. Refuse to give Satan any opportunity. Maybe it's people that are stressing you out and God is about to bless you. And the enemy wants you to live in unforgiveness, because he sees that the angel has been dispatched with the answer and the solution, the tangible answer to the prayer that you've been praying for 5 years. You've been fasting for 5 years. God has released the angel, but now Satan rises and he compels somebody to stress you out so that you live in unforgiveness. Do not allow offense and unforgiveness to stop the answered prayer, the solution, and the tangible blessing that God is bringing in your life. Do not allow this. This is a trick of the enemy. Forgive that person. Let that offense go. Forgive them. Is the enemy trying to stop your prayers? The enemy is trying to block the answered prayer. But when you forgive, the angel will be released. The angel that carries the answer to the prayer that you've been praying will be released. and you will see the answer tangibly in your life. Do not allow people that are being compelled by Satan to put you in a place of bondage, to put you in a prison because of unforgiveness. Child of God, are you walking on the roof that you're not meant to be walking in? You're meant to be fighting wars, but why are you on the roof? Why are you walking at night on the roof? Why have you risen from slumber and sleep when you are meant to be fighting in wars? Why are you in a place of slumber and walking on the roof? What are you looking for at the roof? What are you seeking for at the roof? Maybe you're in a season where now you're at the roof. Do you understand now that you are at the roof? Maybe you know, maybe you're not really sure what season you're in, but I've come to tell you that you're on the roof. It's time to go back to war. It's time to leave the place of slumber and go and fight with the other kings that are fighting concerning the enemies of God. It's time to rise up from the place of slumber. You can still repent today. You can still repent. You've not yet committed adultery. You still have a chance to repent. You still have a chance to say, God, I'm sorry. I'm coming back to serving you in the church. God, I'm so sorry that I've allowed these blessings to take over me. Lord, I come back in humility to serve you. Serve you with all my heart, all my mind, all my soul, and all my strength. Maybe it's this job. They said, you know what? We're going to give you double if you start to work on Sundays. We're going to give you double if you start to work maybe 20 more hours. Those 20 more hours are going to take away from your family. Is it worth it? Is it worth it driving a wedge between you and your family because you want more money? Do you not think that God will bless you because you're serving your family? Because you're doing that which you need to do concerning your family? Do you not think that God will raise up a bonus for you? A financial bonus? A financial blessing in your life? God will. Your first place in the house should be serving your family, serving your spouse and your children. That is your first place, not your job. God is saying, I can still bless you. Be faithful where I've planted you. Some of you, God has just called you to be a good spouse. You're not called on the pulpit. You're just called to serve as a wife, serve as a husband, and serve and train up your children in the Lord. That's where God has called you to be. Be faithful where God has placed you. Why are you not fighting with the other kings? Why are you not fighting where you should be fighting concerning serving in the house, serving your spouse, training up your children? Now your eyes are focused on more money. Why can you not be faithful where God has placed you? You see, the enemy will raise up a Bathsheba there at the job when you're so busy working late nights. God is saying, be faithful where I've placed you. Do not give the enemy a foothold. Do not give the enemy a place in your life. We see David walking on the roof at night, in the middle of the night. He suddenly has this urge to wake up. And he wakes up. He walks on the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman bathing. And the woman was very beautiful to behold. You know, when you read throughout all the Bible, the only two women that the Bible actually says were very beautiful is Sarah and Bathsheba. So I believe the Bible that really this woman was very beautiful to behold. She was irresistible. Her beauty was irresistible. It's something that was so irresistible that David was unable to control himself. You see, every person has a weakness. And it's important that you really understand your weakness. What is your weakness? If you look at the life of David, even how he was conceived, if you look at his family life, there were issues in his family. There were issues in David's generation concerning lust. The spirit of lust was a stronghold in the lineage of David. It's very important that you understand the strongholds of your family. What are the strongholds? What are the demonic forces that have been fighting your generation? Don't be blind to that information. It's very important that you know that information so that you can fight with the sword and fight in knowledge. Don't fight blindly. Just fighting with the sword, you cannot even see the enemy. You cannot even recognize the kind of enemy that you're fighting. You're putting on the full armor of God, but you don't know the kind of enemy that you're fighting. Understand the enemy of your family. Understand the enemy of your generation. What is the enemy? For David, it was lust. David had stepbrothers, even when we see that he's being anointed as king. His father doesn't even bother looking for David. His father doesn't even bother to see that David is missing from this anointing. This great prophet Samuel comes to anoint one of the sons, and nobody thinks to even call David. There was a spirit of rejection that was upon David. There was this spirit of rejection and also a spirit of lust in the family. David had stepbrothers, and we don't know anything about his mother, what kind of a mother she was. We see nothing concerning the mother. There was issues in David's family, and those issues were not dealt with, and they arose when he was in a place of rebellion. You see, the issues in your family, you think you now you're born again, you know, the blood is washed away all the sins, the blood is washed away all the curses, I don't need to be aware of anything. Child of God, do not be a fool, but be wise. The blood, yes, it has washed away all the sins. The blood has given you power over every generational curse. But be wise, because the enemy will still try to fight you. But it is the word of God that makes you to prevail. It is the word of God that makes you to prevail. God's word will make you to prevail. And the blood has given you power to prevail. The blood has given you the victory to prevail. But it's up to you to walk in the victory. It's up to you to walk as a victor. And to walk as a victor, you need the word of God. You need the word of God to walk in success. You need the word of God to walk in victory. It is the word of God that gives you power. It is the word of God walking in the word of God. It is the word of God that shows you who you are. When you look in the mirror of the word, you will know who you are. But if you don't know the word of God, you don't walk in the word of God, how will you be a victor? How will you be victorious, child of God? Do you know the strongholds in your family, child of God? Do you know them? The strongholds in David's family was lust. Lust was one of them, and rejection. And the enemy wanted to come in through that lust to kill, steal, and destroy David. But God had mercy on him. You see, we are living under grace. We live in the realm of mercy and compassion. And just because we live in that realm of mercy and compassion, we must not take advantage of God's mercy. Don't think, you know, I'm going to sin today. Yeah, I'm seeing Bathsheba. She's too irresistible, so I'm not even going to fight this lust that I feel. I'm not even going to fight this temptation, because tomorrow I can repent. Because tomorrow I can go in the presence of God and say I'm sorry, because the blood has already forgiven me. Tomorrow I'm going to tap in by faith into the forgiveness that I have through the blood. Are you like this? Taking advantage of the blood? Taking advantage of the cross? Taking advantage of the King of Kings? When will you repent of the things that you're doing? Asking for forgiveness but going back to the same thing, that means there's a bondage in your life. That means there's a stronghold in your life. That means there needs to be deliverance. Maybe you think, well, there is no bondage. I don't need deliverance. That's pride and arrogance saying that to you. Doing the same thing over and over again, that means that is an addiction. Are you aware that this is an addiction that you need deliverance from? This is an addiction that you need to give to God. This is an addiction you need to surrender to God. You keep doing the same thing and taking advantage of the blood, taking advantage of the work of the cross. It's time to stop taking advantage of the work of the cross. It's time to submit to the plan of God concerning your life. It's time to submit yourself to the word of God. It's time to submit your pain, the hurt, to the Spirit of God who dwells in you. How long will you hinder the Spirit of the Lord in your life? How long will you grieve His Holy Spirit that He has given you? How long shall you grieve God as He sits on His throne? How long? How long will you be lazy, too lazy to walk in the fruits of the Holy Spirit, because you don't study the Word? You don't read the Word. You don't understand it because you don't allow God's Spirit to teach it to you. Child of God, how long will you stop chasing things and just submitting yourself in the presence of the Lord? How long, says the Lord? David did not practice self-control. Yes, this woman was very beautiful, irresistible, but he did not practice self-control. Instead, lust began to take over. You see, when you're outside of the presence of God, When you linger around in the green pastures, you see, the green pastures are beautiful. The green pastures, they make you full. They are a delight to your eyes in this place of comfort, walking beside the still waters, sitting on the green pastures. You begin to linger and linger and linger far away. And Jesus is saying, it's now time to go. It's time to go. It's time to go. Come. My sheep hear my voice, yet you've lingered far away. The Lord is saying, it's now time for a new season. When we need to go through the valley of the shadow of death, this is a new season. You see, I'm about to train you in the valley of the shadow of death. It'll be very dark, but I will be your light. And I'm trying to train you, and we have to go through this valley because you see, the anointing that I want to place over your life, the anointing that overflows, needs you to go through the valley of the shadow of death. You see, the angels of goodness and mercies that open doors for you wherever you go, where things and mountains and rivers begin to move apart for you, you see, you need to go through the valley of the shadow of death. I need you to see and taste what my rod feels like so that you're able to listen to my instruction, so that you're able to understand how things work for those that are mature in the Lord. But yet you, here you are, you've decided to stay in the green pastures. You've decided that you don't want to grow anymore. You've decided that you don't want to propel to another level in God. And you've lingered about in the green pastures. Lingered. Now you don't hear the voice of God. You've stepped outside of the presence of God. And now Bathsheba comes. You know, Bathsheba and her beauty, minding her business. She comes, and here you are. The issues that were in your family have now gripped you. And now, because you're so far away from the presence of the Lord, you cannot hear his voice anymore. It's time to repent today. Will you go back into the presence of the Lord? Will you go back to the things that you used to do before? You still have a chance to repent. Repentance will allow God to shift and change your life. Don't think, oh God, I've done so many wrong things. God, I've already committed adultery. I've already done this with Bathsheba. Bathsheba in this word is a representation of something that you get outside of the presence of God. But God, through his mercies, he seeks you. He's seeking for you to truly repent, to truly turn back from your old ways. You still have a chance today to repent. You have a chance to let go. You have a chance, and God is able to walk you back to the place of relevance, the place where doors are open for you, the place where things are moving concerning his will for your life, the place whereby he can use you again concerning what he wants to do in your life. David sent and inquired about the woman, and someone said, is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah? You see, David sent to find out about this woman, and he's being told information, who her family is, who she is married to. This woman is married. She is taken. This person is taken. This position is taken. That thing is taken. That thing is outside of your place of receiving. That thing is outside of your place of getting. That thing is outside of your boundary. It is outside of the place of even kingship. Yes, you are a king, but this is the daughter of Eliam. This is the wife of Uriah. You may be a king, you may be able to get anything and everything that you want, but this one you cannot get. This one is outside your place. This one is not for you. You see, there are people, even friends, that will see your life, and yet they desire the things that are not for them. Child of God, are you desiring things that are outside your boundary? Maybe it's your friend. Maybe it's your friend's boyfriend, your friend's fiance, your friend's husband. You see that the person is irresistible, and here you are lusting after them. Lusting after them such that you're having false dreams about them. False dreams that come from the pits of hell because you've allowed lust and deceit to enter your heart. Child of God, what is it that you are desiring that is outside of the will of God? Let it go. Don't ruin a friendship because of the evil desires of your heart. Don't ruin your relationship with God because of the evil desires of your heart. Has lust clinged onto you such that now you don't care that this person is taken? You don't care that this is the spouse of someone else, that this person has a spouse. You don't care that this person has their own family. You don't care even about their family to see that this family and my family, we are not meant to be. This is outside a boundary. Maybe you think because you have all these comforts in your life, or all these comforts that are coming, maybe the enemy is deceiving you. And he's saying Bathsheba is your spouse. He's saying this person who is taken is your spouse. Have you allowed deceit to blind your eyes? God has prepared a spouse for you, a spouse that is coming, but you're allowing the enemy to lie to you. Don't allow the enemy to lie to you. Don't allow your heart to develop feelings before you seek God. It's very dangerous to allow yourself to fall in infatuation with somebody that you have not presented before God. You've not even prayed about this person. You've not presented, okay, some of you have presented him to God, but God hasn't said anything. God hasn't spoken, but here you are falling deeper and deeper into infatuation. Falling higher and lower into infatuation. Why have you allowed your heart to fall? Why have you not stopped your heart from falling? Why have you not taken self-control, the fruit of the Spirit? Why have you allowed their beauty, their looks, their physique to take over you? Why have you allowed it? David began to stalk Bathsheba, sending messengers. Who is this person? Who is that woman? Who is she? And these people had no idea that David had seen her naked before. David, in secret, had seen her in a place of transparency. This person did not know that their transparency is going to get them in trouble. There are people in your life, maybe you are being transparent, but your transparency is going to get you in trouble tomorrow. Be careful where you wash yourself. Be careful where you are removing your garments. Be very careful who you are speaking to when you remove your garments. Be very careful where you have decided to wash yourself. Which church are you going to wash yourself? Be very careful, because some are watching. And some, in their lust and the deceit of their heart, they will try to devour you. They will break up your marriage. They will break up your family. Child of God, be very careful where you are washing. Is it a friendship? You've decided to let all your secrets, the secrets of your heart. But little did you know that those secrets, those plans, and those dreams are going to cause you to be sold into Potiphar's house. Be very careful, child of God. Where are you bathing? Where have you removed your clothes? Have you looked to check if anybody is watching you? Have you looked to check if somebody is stalking you? And I hear the Lord saying, social media, social media. Be careful what you put on social media. You are washing yourself on social media, not knowing that there are people watching you, ready to break up your family, ready to break up your marriage, ready to break up your plans. You know, I remember there was a time I shared something about a date night. And all of a sudden, my beloved started to get all these friend requests on his Facebook. And these friend requests were women who were not dressed properly. And the Lord told me, because I shared my date night, this is what happened. The person or the people who had sent these friend requests did it out of jealousy. They did it out of envy. They thought, maybe if we do this, but he's not that kind of a man. They thought, maybe if we do this, maybe incite something. But God is able to reveal all things. God is able to reveal everything to you. God is saying, be careful what you put on social media. There are even friends that will send fake friend requests only to break up what you have. They will come in the guise of, I need help, I need somebody to talk to. But little did you know that they've seen you naked and they want your beauty. They want the beauty in your life. They want the beauty in your marriage. They want the beauty that you carry. Some of them want to dim that beauty. Some of them want to destroy that beauty. Maybe you smile too much and they want to destroy that smile. What is it that you're sharing on social media? David was stalking the woman. Even after hearing that this woman is married, he still sent messengers to her and he took her. And the word took here, if you study it, it looks as if this was a forceful thing. It's something that she had no choice. She had to go. She had no choice but to go. This is a position, it was a difficult position that she was in. You see, sometimes your transparency is going to put you in a difficult position. A position whereby you have no choice but to go. To go in that prison. No choice but to go in that place whereby people are hating you. To go in that place where maybe the enemy is going to devour you. Who and what and where have you been transparent? Bathsheba was taken. She came to David and he lay with her. for she was cleansed from her impurity, and she returned to the house. But Sheba conceived. And then she sent to David and said, I'm with child. And this is when the lies began to increase. The lies, the deceit, the falsehood began to increase. Child of God, maybe you've done certain things and now you find yourself, you have to continually lie. Maybe you're even lying to yourself. Lying to your own mind and to your own heart. Your own lies are poisoning you. Lying to people, but not dealing with the real issue. The real issue, which is lust. Not dealing with the real issue, which is unforgiveness that happened 10, 15 years ago. Now you are lying about your friends, lying about your family, lying to the people that you work with, lying to your spouse. What are you lying about? Why have you allowed the lies to escalate? God is saying, repent. Stop lying. The lies of David began to increase and they began to grow deeper and deeper. The deception was now all over his life. And by this time, the enemy was just laughing, laughing and laughing. But God in his mercy, if you continue to read, he sent Nathan the prophet. I don't know what prophet has been sent to you. I pray that today I am that prophet that has been sent to you to look at your life. Maybe you've fallen into this deception. Maybe the sting of lust has poisoned you to the point whereby you are lying. You are lying and you're deceiving yourself and deceiving others. David sends all these things to Uriah so that he can go back to his house and make love to his wife, so that this baby can be said that it is not David's baby. David was willing to make up such a big lie, to live with such a lie. He was willing. You see, the sting of lust does not make you to think about tomorrow. It's always about the moment. It's always about now. Lust does not think of the future. This is why you must be very careful not to get in a relationship out of lust. Never get into a marriage out of lust, because lust is not prophetic. Lust has no discernment. Lust has no insight. Lust has no perception. Lust has no vision. Lust is superficial. Lust is small-minded. Lust is mediocre. Lust is average. It's always looking at the now. It's always looking at how can I be satisfied today. It has no insight. It is not prophetic. This is why it's important, whatever that you do in life, let it not be out of lust. You know, you can lust after a career, but not know how hard you need to work to achieve certain things in that career. Don't go into a business out of lust. Don't go into a career out of lust, because it requires work. There are steps you will need to take when you enter in there. And if you do it in lust, you will not make it. The marriage won't make it. The career won't make it. The family won't make it. The ministry will not make it. Have you started ministry out of lust? You're seeing people on flyers, people being booked and busy, and out of your lust, you think, you know, I can do it too. You know, I am called to also teach. People have told me that I can teach very well. You know, I share the word and I do this and I do that in church. You know, I can do it too. Don't go into ministry out of lust. Has God called you to be booked and busy? Has God called you to accept all those invitations? Has God called you to do that? Or are you doing it out of lust? You want to be seen by people. You're doing it because you want to show out to other people. Even that job, you want to show out to your family that I too can get a job. I too can get a job of this level. Are you doing things in life out of lust and out of showing people what you're capable of? That means that there's no peace. That means that there's no fulfillment. You're doing things to please other people. You're doing things to please yourself. Let everything that you do, let it be an element of service. Service. Because when there's an element of service, God will bless you. God looks for people that can serve. Can you serve in that job? Service. Can you serve in that ministry? Can you serve if God brings that spouse? Are you going to serve them, or is it out of lust? You're just thinking of the sex. You're not thinking that you need to serve them. You'll need to cook. You need to make teas and coffees. You might need to bake some cakes. You might need to know how diet and food and fruits and vegetables work in the body so that you can serve. Serve in a way that will bring long life in terms of what you eat. Are you willing to serve? Service. Or are you just thinking of yourself? Lust. Lust only thinks about itself. Lust is selfish. Lust never looks at the future. Lust is futile. Lust is short-lived. Is your life and your decisions driven by lust? David's life spiraled in deceit, spiraled into lies, more and more lies, until he killed this husband, until he killed this man, and God was watching. God was watching. You think that God is not watching what you're doing? You think God doesn't know your thoughts, the thoughts of your heart, the evil thoughts of your heart? You think God doesn't know what you're doing? You think God will not speak to his prophets? You know, I feel so sorry for people who are friends with prophets because they don't know that God speaks. I feel so sorry for spouses that are living in lies, but yet they are married to a prophet. God speaks. You see, God will send you his prophet to speak to you. God will send people that can discern and people that know the thoughts of the heart and the intents of the heart. People that can see the fruit of the spirit and the fruit of the flesh. God will send you those people. And when he sends you these people, are you able to repent? Will you look at the issue and will you fix the issue today? I pray that this word may help you to look at the issue. Look at the spiral staircase that you have begun to walk down on. A staircase that might lead you to hell. A staircase that might lead you to murder other people, to kill their dreams, to destroy their marriages, to destroy their lives. The enemy might use you through lust to kill, steal, and destroy other people. Because he's already killed, stealed, and destroyed you by through that open door that you have allowed through disobedience and rebellion. Are you allowing the enemy to infect you such that now you're infecting other people? You're so hurt, now you want to hurt other people. You're so disappointed, you want to disappoint other people. Is the poison of the enemy causing you to poison other people around your life? Today we want to pray. In the mercies of God, in his power, he's able to change that story. He's able to change you, but you have to repent. It's time to repent. Every blockage, every addiction, God is able. God is able to heal you, and he has already healed you through the blood. But by your faith, will you receive that healing today? Will you receive that breakthrough from that addiction today? Will you receive it? If you're able, if you say, yes, I am willing to turn my life around. I'm willing to repent. I'm willing to stop lying and deceiving myself and others. I'm willing to walk again. I'm willing to get up and arise and shine. For my light has come. I'm willing, yes, oh God, I'm willing to not linger around and wander in the green pastures. Though you've given me this comfort, I'm willing to go to the next level with you. If you're like that today, we want to pray. Let's pray.
Sovereign Lord, honor and glory belongs to you, Sovereign God. You deserve all the praise. You deserve all the worship, Lord. You deserve our hearts in full, our minds, our souls, and our strength. All of it, you deserve. Oh God, your people, oh God, that are called according to your name. Lord, some of them have fallen into addictions. Some of them, oh God, have been deceived by the enemy. They've fallen trapped to the devices of the enemy. Lord, I pray by the power of your spirit to release them, oh God, release your child, release your people from prisons, oh God. Prisons, oh God, that have caged them, oh Lord, in their spirit. Spiritual prisons, emotional prisons, oh God, I pray by the power of your spirit, release thy servants, oh God, the people that are called, oh God, according to your name, according to your purposes, according to your good pleasure. Release thy people, Lord, send your angels to release, unlock the doors. Lord, let them draw them out of those prisons. Some of them don't even know that they are prisoned. Some of them don't even want to come out of those prisons. But God, in your mercy, I pray, by the power of your spirit, drag them out. Lord, by the power of your spirit, out of the bondage, out of the addictions. Lord, let there be healing and transformation. Transformation of the heart, transformation of the mind, of the soul. Lord, the marks on the soul. The marks on the soul, let them be clear today. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, those blemishes of the soul, let them be blotted out by the power of your blood. By the blood, let every blemish be rubbed out in the name of Jesus. Every handwriting of requirement contrary to the word of God concerning this child's life, let it be blotted out by the blood of the Lamb without blemish. This we decree and declare in the name of Jesus, the name that is above every other name. In the name of Jesus, Father, I thank you for releasing these people, oh God, from prisons
that the enemy had caged them in. Father, thank you for freedom. Freedom in their hearts, freedom in their minds, Lord. But Father, I pray for wisdom. Wisdom. Give them wisdom and insight. Lord, you said if anyone lacks wisdom, let them come, O God, and ask you. If anyone lacks wisdom, O God, let them ask from you, O God, for you give to all liberally. Lord, I pray for liberal wisdom. Father, in the name of Jesus, liberal, liberal wisdom, O God, overflowing wisdom, supernatural wisdom in the life of your child today. Wisdom, wisdom to not lie, wisdom to not fall into deceit, wisdom to forgive, wisdom to not carry offense, wisdom to know how to fight their enemies and the strongholds that attack their families, wisdom to know how to detect the enemies of the bloodline, oh God, that they carry, wisdom on how to use the sword of the Spirit, wisdom, oh God, in how to put on the full armor of God, wisdom. Lord, give your child wisdom. Wisdom and insight. Wisdom to know that they deserve better than lust. They deserve better than a relationship of lust. They deserve a long, committed marriage. They deserve a committed marriage. Wisdom to know that they deserve time with their family. Wisdom to know to say no to their boss at work. Wisdom on how and why to say no and to say yes. Oh God, your people need wisdom. We need wisdom, Lord. Without your wisdom, we become fools. Oh God, we need thy wisdom, Lord. Without your wisdom, we are fools. Without your wisdom, we have nothing. Without your wisdom, we know nothing, Lord. This is why we need your wisdom. The wisdom that comes from above, wisdom that is not sensual. Lord, release that wisdom upon your child's life. Let it rest upon that helmet of salvation. Oh God, let it rest in the heart, in the core of the heart, in the inner chambers of the heart. Let it rest. Let it dwell there. Let it find room in their heart. Let it blossom in the spring. Let it blossom like spring in that heart. Oh God, I pray in the name of Jesus, even as you sent Nathan to David, Lord, I pray that you have sent me, oh God, and that this word, oh God, may be acceptable in their hearts, that it may produce a harvest of righteousness and holiness in their lives. Father, this we pray, and I pray that you bless your people, even though they messed up. Father, release a blessing. Release a blessing as they position themselves back, oh God, in the place of walking in your acceptable, good, and perfect will. As they go back, oh God, to the place of relevance, the place of instruction, Lord, release your blessing. The blessing that makes them to know, oh God, and not to remember the things that they did in their past. The blessing that overshadows the sicknesses. A blessing that overshadows the hurt, overshadows the mistake. Even as you released a blessing of a child in David's life, you released the blessing of Solomon, and David was able to rejoice again. Lord, let your people rejoice once more, for you are a merciful God. You are full of compassion and kindness, oh God. Let your compassion and kindness fill the heart of your child today. This we pray in the name of Jesus, the name that is above every name. The sting and the poison of lust will not poison your child anymore. Thank you, Father, that they will not be poisoned anymore. Thank you for releasing that bitterness, oh God, by the power of your blood. Thank you for your blood that washes away every poison, every bitterness, every contamination. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that your people may never strive with people, that they do things out of service and not because they want to be seen or not because they want to be clapped for by people, oh God, but let them do things to please you, oh God, I pray, in the name of Jesus. And also I pray for myself, in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen. God bless you. I will see you next week, and may God bless you as you walk in the newness and the boldness and the courage of God. And as you change your life, remember to study the word, remember to fill your heart with the word of God, because in the word of God, that's where there's success. In the book of Joshua, we're told to meditate on the word of God day and night so that you may make your way successful. It is the word of God that brings success in everything that we do. And success is not always to do with money or to do with cars and houses, but success is just basically growth. It's fruitfulness in things that you do. There's fruitfulness, there's growth. And that is what you've been called to do. Even when God created the first man and woman, he said, be fruitful and multiply. Success is a DNA that God placed in our life. It's an inheritance that we have. It's not for certain people or specific kind of people, but it's the blessing on all human race. It's nothing to do with religion, but it's how God created every human being. This is why you see that there are some people who are successful in life, but those people maybe don't know God. It's because the DNA is in us. This is how God created us to be fruitful and to multiply. And I pray that you may tap in. How much more can you tap in when you have the word of God? So don't take the word of God lightly. Study it. Let it fill your heart and your mind. Let it renew your mind. And God, you'll see the hand of God. You'll see the fullness. You'll begin to see dimensions and facets of God that you never knew before. So God bless you. And I don't mean to preach again. If you're saying, oh gosh, she's preaching again, I'm sorry, I can't help it. So I'll see you next week. Take care. Bye.